So hey, I'm Jeff, and
I'm Mike,
and this is the outset of what are we doing?
We're gonna make an amp.
We're gonna make. Neither of us have ever made one before.
No,
but we're gonna try.
Yeah, it'll be fun.
We bought a kit.
Sure.
We'll see how it works out.
Yeah.
The collaboration really got born from. I kind of had the idea of wanting to do an amp with somebody else, and where we could combine the engineering or the approaches from two different companies. And I was talking to Lynn Burke from Blue City Music, who's a dealer for both the Diamond and the Soldano products, right?
Yeah, great.
And Lynn suggested, knowing both of us and knowing a lot of the amp guys the way he does, you know, Lynn suggested, you know, really, you and Mike should do something together. Which was an easy choice for me because even with all the things we do, so many of the things that we still do in the current were really inspired by advances Mike made to guitar amps in the first place. You know, the sort of the modern high gain thing kind of came from the way you advance stuff. So in most ways, those of us that are doing that now are doing things that are very Soldano-ish in the design to begin with. So to me, it made natural sense to want to do something with him. And I know with Martin and myself and the things that we do here, there's origins there too. So it just kind of seemed to make sense to me.
Yeah, yeah. And then, so Lynn had called me and asked me if I'd be interested in talking to you about that. Mm-hmm. And you know, he spoke very highly of your company. And, you know, I knew a little about what you were doing. I didn't know the details of like what your amps were really sounding like at that time, so I did a little of my own research.
Right.
And it seemed like a really good fit, so at that time I finally picked up the phone and called you and said, hey, let's talk about this, and it's worked out.
Yeah, and to me, I think it was a good marriage in a sense, because we, even though we have kind of our take on how we do things and you've got yours, we still do very similar things overall. And
definitely.
Both companies have a good variety of products in the high-end market. Mm-hmm. But then, you know, and of course we've talked in the past. I mean, we knew each other a little more in passing from even before the idea.
Right.
But I kind of went, yeah, you know, Mike would be a great guy to do it with, and it makes perfect sense. So that's really where it came from. And then the real question became, what do we want to make, right?
Right, that's right. Yeah, it's like, okay, now we've decided to do something together, what's it gonna be?
I'll tell you this about that. We knew that the collaborative product was going to be a guitar amp.
So
yes, that's
that
right.
That was the starting point.
These are all the tools we need right here.
Yeah, and we're good to go.
Yeah.
Or we can get the soldering iron and make some changes.
Oh, okay. I was gonna have fun with this, so.
Is the iron hot?
Don't you touch my soldering iron.
Whose soldering iron is it? I don't know where you buy it.
I think I've got my smell on that.
You did not heat it up yet. It's not on.
There we go.
The red light has to be on.
Yeah, that's the...
Oh, that's what that thing is?
I'm glad that's on tape.
It's like the... It's like the Simpsons episode. That light, sir, definitely indicates that it is not on. What does it do? You should ask what you can do for it. Since that's hot.
Yeah, wow, look at that.
We're gonna plug it in there.
Starts chattering about halfway through.
Yeah.
Hey there.
Hey, I'm Louise.
I am Wade, you seek south.
The name 327 SD came from the fact that we, you know, Jeff, knowing that I'm really automotively inclined and like muscle cars and all kinds of stuff, he asked me like, well, what kind of, you know, car references do you like? You know, maybe we should go in that direction. And so one of my very all-time favorite engines is the 327 Chevy V8. And so he's like, I love that, let's just do that, and then let's take our two names and put them together. So S for Soldano, D for Diamond, and we put it together, and SD327.
And it sounded way cooler than the leader bike or the 1000cc.
Yes.
So
sounded way cooler.
Those are the engines I know, so that worked out much better,
yeah.
I think. Plus, I thought it was really particularly cool too, because I knew that I really wanted to incorporate the hot rod vibe.
Right.
And that's really where the styling of the amp came from. Yes. Was the hot rod vibe, right? With the racing stripe look.
My favorite thing, the red line on the numbering on the pots. It goes up and then it hits red line and the coloring changes just like on a tachometer.
In the 9 and 10?
Yeah, yeah, brilliant. I love it. Yeah, and the stripes, very cool. It's got a great car look to it.
You know, the grill insert actually was the basic shape of the front of the old GT500 grill.
Ah, yes, right.
Because remember, the original one that I put together had a little bit different shape. It was similar, but it was a little more, I don't know. And we, when we reshaped it, looked at the front of the GT500, and I actually looked at a Camaro grill as well, but they just didn't seem to fit as good. But that front of the GT500 shape fit really nicely.
Right.
And of course, you've got, with the racing stripe, it's got the whole hot rod theme, because you see that so frequently on hot rods that it made sense. But that's also the reason why we did all the chrome accents, where the chrome corners go and the chrome knobs and all the chrome hardware. That was, so much in cars, modern, you see them more blacked out, but in hot rods, there's so much.
There's still chrome. Back then, they actually still used metal in cars, unlike nowadays where everything's plastic.
Exactly. It's a wood-like substance.
A wood-like substance, that's right. I decided that if I was going to do something, I wanted to do something that was kind of high-end and reflective of what I already do in that respect. And so this is a very high quality product, and so I felt good putting my name on something like that, because it's what I'm known for. And it was kind of important for me too that it was something that was made in America, because I'm very much about that in my own philosophical standings and stuff, since I've been an American-made amp company for nearly 30 years. So it was a good fit for that reason.
Yeah, I think you even said something like that when we talked about it, because that was one of the first things I remember you saying when we talked about the collaborative idea, was whatever it's going to be, I want it to be a high-end, I want it to be a quality build, I want it to be American-made, and I want it to fit what your company, meaning mine, and your company, meaning yours, is known for, which is top of the line, solid build, best components, high-end product. And I think that was one of the first things Mike expressed, was the product needs to be in that vein, and that's really what we did. It's the same quality build that you're used to from the Soldano products and from us, and it's strictly a high-end piece.
Yeah.
But the way I
equate it is, it's kind of like having, say, a car with a, because I'm a car guy, so I always make car analogies.
You're in good company, brother.
Good, awesome. Well, so I look at different, like, you can either get your gain by easing it up to the point. So like I see like a well-designed high gain amp, kind of like having a nice close ratio 6-speed manual transmission, where you don't really do a lot with each gear change, but eventually you get up to a really high speed because you've taken these little baby steps getting there. Whereas I see how some of these guys do it when they're trying to, for whatever reasons, economy or whatever, and using fewer tubes, they'll sit there and they'll try to go from first gear into fourth gear without using second or third. And it's just, they're dumping everything into one gear change. And it just doesn't
well, I saw out. I saw a drawing. I haven't seen it yet.
One of the questions that some of the people in the market have asked is just generally about kind of the story about how it was a collaborative effort. I suggested to people when we were doing this that one of the cool things about it was that it was a true merging of the two different approaches to the amplifiers. When you really look at the finished product, you've got our platform in switching, which is done very differently than yours is, right?
That's very good.
We've got our clean, but then we use your power structure with the 5881 side.
Yeah.
where we've traditionally done 34s, yes. Although we're moving actually to 5881.
Oh, it's down over there.
Is there, should we change this to?
yeah. Flux capacitor.
Where's the... Well, come on, man, are you guys left?
And then the Crunch channel was a true amalgamation. I mean, that was a start with our channel, which really had its origins in your channel, which then got modified. And I think, if I remember right, didn't we even when we first talked about it, I think I even said something like, I want to start kind of in the area of the SLO.
Yes.
But I don't, not necessarily the right word, but I kind of want to maybe modernize it or shape it into a little bit newer voicing with the extra aggression, maybe roll off the high a little bit.
Exactly, and that was a thing, and that's why earlier on I was using that term more aggressive, because like I say, the SLO is it's a very versatile amp, and you can play just about anything through it, but it's got this certain... this certain finish to it that's very almost polished. And I thought when you and I spoke about this amp is because we wanted to go for a more modern kind of, you know, like, I don't use the term metal very much anymore because right. It's such a hard thing to define because it's so, there's so much to it these days. But I kind of thought that the idea here was to give something that had more of that modern metal kind of vibe, in that it wasn't quite so polished around the edge, where if you kind of rubbed it wrong, it would actually scar you, you know, and that kind of thing. And
that's actually a really good point. And I think now that I think about it, it might be a really good way to describe it. Where one of the differences I think between what you've done traditionally and what we've done is your amps to me have always had a very polished, elegant, refined feel to them. We tend to steer a little more towards the rawer side, a little more attitude side.
Attitude, that's a good word for it, yeah.
Yeah, and I think the gain channel on this amp really fits nicely in between. It's got that elegance in there, but you can also get the aggression and the attitude.
Yeah, and that was what I was going for. I wanted to capture your vibe, but give it sort of my
voicing.
My voicing on how to make it happen. Exactly.
The second, third gain stages in the overdrive section to give it more compression and to balance out the waveform so that it's clicking more evenly on both the cathode and plate side. And
that's good though, because that'll give it a little more Soldano.
That's the whole secret to the Soldano.
We may want to make some small modifications to the bright caps.
Yeah, well, I'll voice it more like what I would think it would sound like, probably a little bit fatter in the mids and a little bit less. Maybe the bright caps will be a little less bright and kind of more of an upper mid boost rather than just. And part of it is because of kind of where all the good stuff is. Like when a tube breaks up, I mean, you know, you see it on the scope, you know, the wave comes up, and then when you finally hit the rail and you run out of B plus on that side, or the tube's capability of flowing any more current, that's where you start squaring off in the top. And then it goes the other way until you get cathode cut off, and then it squares off in the bottom. But all the good stuff happens right as it's squaring off. Once it's flat, it's crap. Yeah, it's a square wave, you know. So it's right there in that little curvy part. And so if you take it up easily so that every tube is just getting to the curvy part and not much beyond it, that's where you get the really luscious overtone and all the harmonic content. And that's what makes an amp really sound good. And so that's...
Which should give it more of an overall rock sound, a little bit less of a metal sound.
Yes, exactly, cool. Exactly.
It probably will make it fuller overall too, which would be cool.
Yeah, it fills it out. It's kind of a bigger, rounder sound. It's kind of, you know, I hate to use the term, but classic rock, you know.
Right.
And but it's really useful. You know, it's a very versatile kind of deal. And when it's at full gain, it'll give it more stability so that when you do hit notes, there's still some definition and articulation. The biggest problem I have with many high gain amps is that it just starts sounding like just bleh. In other words, if you play just a simple fifth, it'll sound fine.
That's right.
But the minute you try to play like a minor chord or some kind of diminished chord,
definition.
It's just bleh. You know, it's just like
And that's good too. We probably won't need major changes there, because that's one of the things we get a lot of good press for, is the clarity. So
that's why I like the clean sound. The clean is, it does it so well. So
that, with the voice, the overall voicing change, would give it a nice mix between the two.
Yes.
That happens sometimes. You can be in it, Mike.
It, nothing aggravates people more than seeing a pit glued somewhere or a quarter.
Right.
Quarter. Yeah, the step out front.
Through a 112?
No, it's a...
A half 12?
It's not even. It's a something. It's a prototype neodymium speaker that no one uses.
Oh, come on. Give me the ragtime legs.
Question really is what makes, I think, this amp unique to both our line and to your line. Even though the platform came from our configuration in the way we do the switching and the way we do the different channels, the voicing is really what's unique for it, for us, for the Diamond products. We tend to do, I hate to use the term, a little more high gain, because we both do very high gain stuff, but
right.
The way that we saturate and the way that we have the breakup in our gain is on more of our products is typically more geared to the heavier rock sound.
Right.
Even though
we definitely
have things like the Spitfire or the Hammersmith, which is much more vintage sounding. This amp, I think, was unique for us because even with the higher gain, it didn't saturate as much. It was more controllable.
Okay.
And that made it kind of a fuller, more heavier rock sound. And I think it gave it a whole different feel. For us, it sort of fits kind of within the Spitfire to the Heretic range, but it's got that nice place in the middle and it's extremely versatile. And it's got that Soldano flavor, but for my taste, I don't know how you feel about it, but I think it even differs from a lot of the way that your stuff sounds too.
Oh yeah, it's definitely, you can hear that. My sound's definitely in there. I mean, it's really obvious, but it's different in that, for one thing, your clean channel is different than what I do for clean, but it's a very cool clean channel. I like it a lot. And I think that overall, tied in with kind of more of how I do the high gain thing, which is what we've done in this amp, it's kind of melded two different things together to make it something that I would consider this to be a more aggressive amp than, say, what I build. I think my stuff is maybe a little bit more I wouldn't say subdued, but I think it's just a little bit more I'm at a loss, but I'd say it spans kind of a broader usability range.
Right.
Whereas this can really, it's focused at rocking out. I mean, it's got a very, like, this is going to peel paint. You know?
Yeah, this is an amp you're going to turn up, and it's got some attitude.
Yeah, exactly, exactly, exactly. It's an attitude thing.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So people have asked why we did a limited edition, because, you know, we initially scheduled the production to be 50 of them as you're looking at it, and then we did the uber limited, not to be confused with the Uber ride service, silver with the black stripes that we only did 10 of. I think the best answer to that question probably is it was fun to make it limited and make it cool. I don't think that we actually put any more thought into it other than let's not make a whole bunch of them. Let's make it kind of a cool, neat.
Yeah, let's have some fun with this one and just make a handful of them and just for the sake of doing it.
Yeah, there's something to be said for something, especially in the guitar market, there's something to be said that's for, it's not just available to everybody for the rest of eternity. There's kind of a cool thing about getting your sound from a piece that's unique that not every guitar player can walk into Guitar Center and buy, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the other thing too is, sometimes when you do things like this, you do them just because you want to do it,
right,
and not because you're really, you know, trying to, you know, have the next major seller. You're just doing it because you want to do it. And at that point, if you do 50 of them, that's all you need.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're done and you move on to the next cool thing.
I'm going to go with yes.
I'd say yes is a good answer.
Yeah. I think we both had a really good experience putting this together. It came together nicely. It's been a really good collaborative effort because there's been no ego involved in it. No, it's got to be our way. And when you do that, I think we both looked at it as a way of saying, hey, and in fact, I think you even said when you were interviewed for the press release that the idea of bringing fresh approaches, and when you look at somebody else's approach, it sort of makes you, because we both get so used to looking at things the way we look at them over time, and you get that fresh approach, it opens you up to new ideas.
That's right, correct. Yeah, it really does. It's always nice to sometimes be able to step back from something and have somebody else put their eyes on it, or their ears in this case, and go, well, you know, that's really cool what you're doing, but I kind of heard it this way. And then you're like, oh, you know, I didn't think about that.
Right.
You know, and so that's what's kind of been fun is, you know, Jeff has quite a bit different client base than I have. And so when you bring the feedback from your clients to me, and then I can mix that with what I get back from my customers, we come up with something really new and fresh.
Well, that's the whole idea. And so the idea of working on something together, I can tell you this, we know what it won't be. It's not going to be a variation of this or another variation of that. I think that at least our concept was, let's do something different, right? Yeah. Not an also and product. We don't want to be another flavor of the month. We don't want to be our Plexi take or our whatever right. take. Something that was different in not only its voicing, but its whole structure.
Yeah.
You know, whether it's a, let's do a single channel thing with this way, or let's do this instead of that. So it'll be something more, it'll be something different and a little different for both of the lines as well.
Yeah, I think it'll be something fresh that neither one of us has done yet. And yet it'll be something that'll still reflect what we are, but completely unique to anything else we've done.
Like a motorcycle with a car engine?
Yeah, that'd be a great idea.
That might be the next product.
Yeah, there we go.
I'll take this one.
Go for it.
I'm gonna say no. Wait, the question was, are we gonna do a combo? The answer's still no. In any event, I'm Jeff. And
I'm Mike.
And you've been listening to us drone on and on about what we decided to do with the 327 SD. Hopefully, at this point in the video, you're still paying attention to what we're talking about. If you are, congratulations, you made it this far. If you're not, we get it, but we hope you like it. It's the 327 SD by Soldano and Diamond. Wave bye.